Hey guys, Aaron here from Guff Custom. So this machine you can see behind me is a 1996 Fidel VMC 15 that I've been fixing up, and it's going to take over production of all of my knives from my older machine, Millie. So most of the work on this machine's already been done, but I missed one really important thing, which is I found some lost motion in the Z-axis. And obviously lost motion is a real problem when I'm trying to do high precision machining, so I have to fix it. So I thought you guys might like to join me as I go through the process of diagnosing and fixing this. So when we have lost motion in a machine like this, what does that actually mean? What it means is that the computer thinks that it's moving the table back and forth a set amount, but if something in here is worn out, it has to take up that worn slop. So you can imagine if I'm trying to move this hand with this hand and there's a gap between them, then I have to move it this much before I start moving my other hand. There are a couple of sources of lost motion. There's the ball screw and the ball nut itself. There are the thrust bearings. So the thrust bearings here are what's responsible for allowing the ball screw to rotate, but not to move back and forth. And then there's the coupling here. So the coupling is what joins the servo motor to the ball screw. Now, in my experience, the most likely culprit of, you know, large amounts of lost motion, of backlash, are the thrust bearings. And the reason that this is the case is because all of the wear and tear in a thrust bearing is concentrated in exactly one spot right here, because they just turn around in a single location. Whereas with a ball screw, the wear and tear is spread out over the length of the ball screw. And the reason that this is actually a good thing is because the replacing the thrust bearings is about $100, whereas the ball screw itself is about $1,000. So fingers crossed that it's the thrust bearings and not the ball screw. This is what a ball screw looks like. The reason it's called a ball screw is because there are half round channels cut into the screw and also into the nut itself. And then in those channels inside the nut, there are actually ball bearings that act as the interface between the ball nut and the ball screw. What this does is it allows it to rotate and to follow the threads, but with very little friction, because the ball bearings actually roll inside the channel, as opposed to like a traditional nut and bolt where you have metal on metal scraping as it turns. In a standard nut and bolt, about the best power efficiency that you can get is 40 to 50%. In a ball screw like this, the best power efficiency you can get is 90%+. So it creates a lot less heat, creates a lot less friction. It allows you to accelerate loads more quickly and more accurately. Okay, so to measure the lost motion in the y-axis, what we're going to do is put an indicator up against the outside of the spindle housing, and now we're going to move 0.05 away from the indicator. So we should see the needle move from 0 to 5 on the left there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so we can see that it moved, but it didn't quite move exactly to the 5 mark. So what I'm gonna do is line it back up with 0, add 0.2 of an inch of backlash compensation. And now we're gonna move back the other way again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you can see all of a sudden it's lined up. And that is actually lined up perfectly. It's just because of the angle of the camera, it doesn't quite look like the indicator needle is on that 5. Let's look at what the Z-axis looks like. Okay, so we've got the indicator on the underneath of the face of the spindle. Let's see what happens when we move that axis by 0.005 of an inch. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you can see there we've got a significant amount of lost motion. We've lost over 0.001 of an inch. And then let's line it up with that 5. And then we're gonna move it in 0.010 increments left and then right. That should be moving from 5 to 5, and it's not. You can see we're losing quite a lot of motion there. So we need to fix this. Now, to work out where the problem actually is, we have to go through and diagnose the machine. And the way we're going to do that is actually by putting an indicator on the end of the screw. Because what will happen is, if the thrust bearing is worn and loose, then when the machine tries to move back and forth, the screw itself will actually end up moving back and forth. Now it's time to start disassembling the machine so I can get access to the Z-axis ball screw. To do this, I need to remove the bay covers, some of the overhead covers, and the head cover. You can see the protruding end of the Z-axis ball screw. And when I move that axis, even by just a 1/10 of an inch, you can see it rotating. And what we need to do is to measure the end of the ball screw for movement up or down. Unfortunately, we can't just do that by putting an indicator on the face of the ball screw, because if the face of the ball screw is not perfectly flat, then as we rotate it, the indicator will go up or down depending on that surface. So the trick is that pretty much all ball screws have a hole in the end of them. And the reason for that is so that they can hang on to the end of the ball screw while they're machining it. So we're gonna make use of that hole by sticking a ball bearing in the end of the hole and then trapping it in place with the needle of the indicator. Then that gives us a perfect surface to indicate off, even though the ball screw is rotating. So I've just put a little tiny bit of grease in there. You can see that that ball bearing is actually sticking onto the end of the ball screw there. I've got an indicator in there pressed up against the ball bearing that's on the bottom of that ball screw. And now I'm gonna jog the Z-axis, and theoretically, if the thrust bearings don't have any play in them at all, then there should be zero change on the indicator. But we can see straight away that whenever I reverse the direction, the ball screw itself is moving a significant amount. We've just identified that our problem is in fact the thrust bearings, which is great news. The next step is actually to take apart the entire Z-axis. The Z-axis has a counterweight, and when the head goes up, the counterweight goes down. The only problem is if there's any mismatch in the balance, which there always is, then it's gonna be pulling in one direction or the other. And that means that when we take the ball screw out, the whole system's gonna wanna move in one direction or the other. The first thing we have to do is actually to block the Z-axis in place so that we can safely take the ball screw out. This is the thrust bearing mounting block, and then this is the ball screw itself. And then down here, you see the ball screw mounted onto the Z-axis head casting.
Victory!
Ooh, she dirty. Wow, so we can actually see, as soon as I've got this out, we can see how badly fucked this thing is. If you listen and watch really closely, you can actually see the ball screw moving inside the assembly.
I can't believe how bad that is. I'm surprised it's working at all.
So now we have a nut here that holds the thrust bearings onto the ball screw. And when I first started working on these machines, I was told that the correct way to remove this nut was to grind flats onto this part of the ball screw and then to use a pair of wrenches. But that is absolutely not the way. This is the way. That's it.
So now we need to take off the thrust bearing retainer here. Ooh, these are very loose. Is that the problem? Fuck. Okay. These two nuts, these two bolts rather, were totally loose, and tightening them up has completely taken the wobble out of this assembly. I think that some clown worked on this and forgot to put it back together properly. This outer bearing retainer is actually heat shrunk onto that bearing. So to remove it, we need to heat it up, but I don't want to melt the seal here in case this stack is still good and we can reuse it. Wrap this with a damp rag just to try and protect. Like, the inside of this is spotless. So I'm gonna put her back together and tighten her up properly, like actually put these bolts back in the way they're supposed to be, and see how it comes together. If that's actually the problem, like if those two bolts were the problem, like really? God damn, this thing's fun.
Okay, so I've got the indicator set up on the bottom of the spindle nose. I'm just gonna get it to zero. And then, moment of truth, we're gonna count 5/1000ths out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is fucking beautiful. That is very, very close to perfect. So let's comp out 1/10th worth of backlash and see what happens. So the camera's not quite lined up with the dial, but looking at it from perfectly lined up with the dial, I now see zero backlash. Alright guys, so let's have a quick look at that blade we just machined. So this is the one we just machined, and then this is one that I machined before I fixed the Z-axis. And if you have a look at this one, you can see straight away that this is not good. So comparing that to the one we just machined, this looks really good. So it's awesome that the machine is fixed. It seems to be running really nicely now, which is fantastic. I've done quite a bit of work on this machine apart from what you just saw. Lots of cleaning and a bunch of electrical work and so on. So I think it's a worthwhile investment. I got these machines very inexpensively, and spending some money on fixing them up isn't a problem. In this case, we didn't have to spend any money, which is amazing. I can't believe that the problem was just those two bolts. It's so silly. Hopefully you guys enjoyed coming to work with me and working on this machine, and I'll see you guys again soon. If you liked this video and would like to see more like it, please make sure you subscribe. Also make sure to hit the notification bell so you get notified whenever I upload a new video. If you learned something from this video and would like to help me make more like it, then please consider becoming a patron. My Patreon account is linked underneath the video.